clever guy who kept reinventing himself. I mean, let's just get into it, because I'll show you. I don't want to just talk about it. I don't want to get to Michelle. Anyway, here's a picture of him when he was probably about 35.
He's about 23, I'd say.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I saw it attributed to him at a later date. Well, he was much more focused than this, I can tell you.
It looks better when it's this big.
Well, okay, now, when Don, and his real name was Donato Francisco Rico, either Junior or the second, depending on my source, which did he like to use?
Actually, you become a second if you're named after your grandfather.
Oh.
You were a junior if you're named after your father.
Okay.
So he is a second in that sense.
Oh, okay, good, thank you. But when he was 12 years old, he was considered a very promising artist. And he won a scholarship, and he was sent to work with the man who commonly gets the credit for the first graphic artist career. Named Lynn Ward. And see, these are wooden
engravings.
I'm sorry?
Wooden engravings.
Engravings, yes. And this was stuff that he did when he was a teenager and in his 20s. And quite honestly, when I knew Don, I'd look at this stuff and go, yeah, well, that's old time stuff. There's Don. Now I look at this stuff and I think, geez, this stuff is brilliant.
Well, this is for the WPA, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I look at the WPA, yeah. These are actually 2 or 3 inches square. They're little teeny things that are engraved on wood and printed.
And each one has just like a 1 or 2 word title, like forlorn or something. I mean, they aren't happy drawings, but they're definitely genuine human emotion. Yeah.
Okay. In the early 40s, Don started working for comic books. And he worked on a lot of unusual things. I don't even know if Dr. Horror was a regular character or not, or where he appeared in. But let me tell you about some of the main things that he did work on.
These are in random order by category.
Okay, well, that's fine. That's all I asked from you. He worked on such things as The Fighting Yank and Black Hood. Black Hood was for Archie, the other was for a company called Better Publications. He worked for Fox on Captain Marvel, on the Patrol and Bullet Man. He worked for Fox on a number of characters, Blue Beetle, and The Sorcerers of Doom was a title that I just think you like. You already mentioned that. And you were going to tell something about Falcon.
Oh, yeah. Don had started a character, and I don't, this was long before I met him, but he had started a character called Flick Falcon. I don't know what Flick Falcon was doing, but he was some sort of heroic character. Unfortunately, the L and the I tended to go together when they were printed. I have to change it to Flip Falcon.
A lot of cartoonists wanted to see if their editor could have a free martini lunch or
something. There was somebody.
That's why my Oddball Comics book will exist. It's stuff that everybody snuck past the editor.
I'm sure you know that there was some comic book writer who decided, he was told you couldn't do that L-I thing because they would run together and make a U. So he named his character Clint Flicker.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay, war comics. I mean, Don did every genre. Here's a book that he actually did about how to write comics. And I remember seeing this, but I don't even have it.
But you can see he was a very inventive guy. He worked in comics.
I think this came out in the 70s.
Oh, when he was working at Marvel, by the way, he worked for Marvel in the 40s. His first published piece was in a very early issue of Captain America, the backup story. But he somehow got, when he was working at Marvel in the early 50s, they thanked him having him co-create Jungle Women. And
Jane of the Jungle is one of them, and the other one was Lorne of the Jungle Queen. And they were all just ripped off of She's Queen of the Jungle. But that's what Marvel did at the time. They found out what was popular, and then did 20 books with the same type of character, and then waited until that bombed out, and they done something else.
What do you mean, what?
Well, yeah, they're still doing that, I think.
Yeah. Oh, we're not going to get to this yet, because quite honestly, it doesn't exist.
But we're looking at it.
Well, you're looking at it, but let me tell you. The characters that Don, I think, was proudest of working on, at least the ones that he always talked about and did a lot of drawings of after he more or less retired, was the Claw and Daredevil. And the Claw was this gigantic, offensive Asian stereotype where he had fangs and claws and bugs flying out of his ears. I don't know what it was all. And Daredevil wasn't our Daredevil, was the guy that like, had the spikes in the belly.
That guy.
Yeah, that guy.
But this is something Don did in the 70s. I bought copies of both these covers. And, I never knew if he was a considering influence, but I kind of feel Chester's blown kind of behind it. Anyway, let's keep going. Okay. That Marvel book, everybody says that he co-created Black Widow. You should say he did create Black Widow because someday Marvel will come to your door and say, oh, here's a check.
I'm not holding my breath for that.
Well, don't. As long as people believe it. Michelle indicates that N. Korok never existed. That was not a name that Don would have ever used. So we have no idea who was acting the co-creator of Black Widow. Anyway,
let go. Disney seems to think it's better to throw money at people than to have to deal with complaints.
They give Don a screen credit whenever the Black Widow appears.
But Don did write some stuff for Marvel in the 60s.
He wrote and drew and edited for Marvel. He complains about the quality of Marvel's stories and says that if you think that's they're no good, then why don't you do it? And he did.
Well, that was another one in the 1950s.
Yeah.
And I am a very reliable source that let me know that Don told him, Stan said, I need you to be my editor so you can be the guy that fires people. So Stan must have thought Don was even more charming than he was if he had gave him that kind of job.
Oh, this is very early, but he did the cover and the entire interiors for a Classic Illustrated, one of the very earliest Classic Illustrated.
Which is certainly a story.
Well, okay, let's keep
going. All right. Then after he moved to the West Coast in the 50s, he mainly concentrated on his writing. And Don wrote over 60 books, probably more because we used a lot of pseudonyms. But these were, well, Jim, just be going through a Gothic, lesbian, breast.
That was part of the series. That the reggae girl.
Oh, the man from Pan.
Look at that. Look at that.
We offend our gay members.
Okay, that's the cowboy. Yeah. That was a series.
That's the gay thing.
No, the man from Pan. No, that was a different.
Yes, there.
The man from Pan was a guy who was the president's secret agent, and he went undercover. He went undercover pretending to be gay to get information for the FBI or somebody, but he was a straight person, and so part of the game on this was that he was never having gay sex because he wasn't gay, and he was never having straight sex because he would be right up to the edge with some girl and he would be afraid that his cover would be exposed and that he would not be thought of as gay person if he was. He never got laid in 3 books.
That's actually more clever than offensive.
It was very funny.
The guy didn't win in any way.
We had no idea it was going to be called The Man from Pansy. That was his editor. The second book was The Daisy Dilemma. The third book was called The Passion Flower Puzzle. And by the fourth book, Lampson Book said, we want to own the characters. And Don came home with a contract that said, basically, we own the character, we own everything connected to the character. He said to me, do you think I should sign this? And I said, you're out of your mind. And they killed the character off.
Oh, Don also did, this was a movie poster that Don did. This wasn't released under the title Secret World War, though. It was mostly a bunch of World War II clips, and they wound up releasing it as G-Men Forever in the Firestein Theater, where he wrote all the dialogue. So I think when Don did this, it was probably a much straighter movie.
So these were all, they took all the old Saturday morning serials and cut them into one story.
Yeah, that might have been an issue, too. But they were all like out of the serial.
Yeah.
Okay, what else do we have?
We have
that. Oh,
that's the clock, actually.
Oh, and that's not Donald.
There we are.
Yeah.
Clock.
There's the claw.
There you go. And there's
Kramer. And that animal he pulled was really fit. Go back. What's going on with that?
I don't even know. I don't even have arms and legs and I'm mad. Let me go.
This isn't Don's cover, this is Alex Schoenberg's cover, but this was Roy when he was doing The Invaders. Roy got, I believe, Carl Burgos, Schoenberg, and Don each draw a chapter with the Golden Age characters who were the fifth effect. It was heated in World War II. So it was really kind of Roy pulling a rabbit out of the hat saying, here's a Golden Age comic.
And it was actually extremely good.
Yeah. I think Invaders was one of the strongest books Marvel was doing at that time.
But it had Frank Springer and Frank Robbins art, so people didn't like it, but it was...
I liked it. I thought it was original from it. I liked their work very much together. Anyway, let's get to Michelle. How much
okay,
more do we have?
That's it.
All right, well, anything you would like to add? It was better for fun for you.
No, actually...
When I talked to Don many, many years ago, he also said that he had written books as a woman.
Yeah.
A lesbian book.
Yeah. Anything that was lesbian themed had to be published under a female pseudonym because the assumption was that men didn't understand anything about lesbians. Which, in fact, they may not. I'm not qualified to explain
that. I don't. Well, I know in Japan they have, like, 8 comic books that are all written by straight